3, 2, 1. It is a great honor and a proud pleasure to present the President of the Indian Orthopedic Association to give this plenary lecture in the CME of the 50th annual conference of the Andhra Pradesh state, where he will hold our hands and walk through his 35-year journey in managing intertrochanteric fractures, which are probably the commonest surgical fractures handled by any surgeon of any age in any locality. Over to Dr. Shiva Shankar of Solapur.
Thank you very much, Dr. Prakash, and thank you very much, WhatsAppCon, for this honor to have my lecture in one of your conference. WhatsAppCon is not new to me. I have attended many of them, including the last few at Kakinada, then Amlapuram, and so many places. Coming to my talk, my journey of over three decades with intertrochanteric fracture, and I will be also covering about what are the predictors of good outcome in the intramedullary hip implant, that is the PFN. This I will cover in the next 25 minutes. To begin with, I would like to say that I did my MBBS from Government Medical College, Hubli. Then from Solapur, through All India Entrance, I came and I did my post-graduation in orthopedics. Why I'm telling it? In Solapur, both the ortho units were headed by two honorary professors. They were full-time private practitioners and they were partly working in the government setup as the unit chief. You all might be knowing the founder president of NAILS, that is Professor Vishwanath Iyer, and also the Daga Nail fame, Professor Dr. K.P. Daga. They were heading both the units. I have worked in both the units, and in the orthopedic department, the unwritten rule is when a junior houseman comes, he will be in the first 6 months, we'll be doing radius ulna nailing, tibia nailing, and femur K nailing. In the next 6 months, he'll be doing duet nail plate. Then in the second year, much more complicated cases like AMP, Richards, DHS were done. And in the third year, major surgeries, including spine, were being done. So we in the department had a lot of SP nail plate, which were not used earlier, but the government supply was Juvet at that time. Juvet was always in short supply, and DHS or the Richards hip screw was not available, which the patient had to purchase if they wanted this implant to be put. So I had the opportunity to use all of them. On the left, you can see the SP nail plate, and on the right, you can see the Juvet nail plate. These are the surgeries I was doing as a resident in 88, 89, and 90 at Solapur. A word about how we were taking an X-ray at that time. So we used to take X-ray in the OT with a portable X-ray machine, which was between 15 MA to 50 MA machine. And the X-ray film had to be developed. Then it has to be fixed drying, which takes almost 15 to 20 minutes before the X-ray comes to the hand of the surgeon, especially when our OT was almost 200 feet away from the X-ray department. It was taking additional time for the X-ray technician to change the clothes, come to the OT, all those things, which you normally used to take almost half an hour for getting one AP and lateral picture of the X-ray. Why I'm telling you this is the junior people will not understand how we were doing X-ray, because they're all used to CM nowadays. With the click of a button, you get the AP lateral picture, which was not the case earlier. We used to put 2-3 guide wires into the hip, and these guide wires, one of them used to be better than the other, and we used to accept whatever was the most best positioned guide wire in that. And on certain days, there was no X-ray control in the operation theater. On those days, what we used to do was, instead of taking the lateral exposure to the hip, we used to extend the incision to Watson-Jones incision. We used to feel the neck by the finger, index finger. We used to feel the neck anteriorly inferiorly, superiorly, and we used to blindly pass the guide wire and then hammer the SP nail plate. So this is one of the such case where which has been done by me only. So we used to do such things also. The SP nail had a plate which was very thin. The plate was very thin, and many a time it used to bend. And on the right side picture, you can see that the SP nail has to be fixed to the plate with the help of a screw. And because the SP plate was bending majority of the time, the McLaughlin plate came into the picture, which was much more thicker, and there were this plate had serrations. So because of the serration, locking between the plate and the nail was better. But even then, many a time it used to get dislodged. The advantage of this SP nail and the McLaughlin plates were, you can, with the same implant, you can fix the nail to any angle which is required, because the hole in the plate was oblong. You could fix the nail at different angles to them. Thanks to lockdown, I could search majority of my slides. I have got over 7,000 slides which were taken in 5 years, short span of 5 years before the digital era came into picture. So these are some of the slides which I was going through. This is one of the case I have done as a lecturer in the department. I have used for a subtrochanteric fracture SP nail plate. Unfortunately, that didn't work well. As you can see, the plate implant has failed because of the thin flimsy plate of the SP nail. So that is one disadvantage of this. This is another case not done by me, but I got this follow-up of this patient. Again, in this patient also, the plate has bent, you can see. So this is the problem we were facing because of the inferior quality metal available at that time. Another problem was the disengagement of the plate with the nail. That is also one of the reasons. So Jewett nail became more popular. Jewett nail was a single implant with the SP nail at the tip and the plate fixed to the nail. So it was much more stronger like the McLaughlin plate. And we started using it. And it was very good implant, especially if done well for a stable fractures. But for unstable fractures, it used to be, especially if there is a subtrochanteric fracture, uncontrolled medialization was causing the penetration into the hip joint. That was the problem we faced with the Jewett nail plate. So because of the problem of the penetration into the hip was more common with the Jewett nail plate, sliding hip screw became more popular in the early 90s. This sliding hip screw was manufactured by a company called Richards in America. So it is popularly called as Richards hip screw. And the sliding mechanism of the screw within the barrel was allowing increased gradual contact, and also the penetration into the hip could be avoided. This was also an important, useful implant, which all of us have used nowadays, and it is still in the market, and it's one of the gold standard at present as far as the extramedullary implant for the hip is concerned. So sliding hip screw was also very good, especially for stable fractures and even for subtrochanteric fractures. This is one of my own case from the slide I have copied, where I have used it for a subtrochanteric fracture. The sliding hip screw is a gold standard for stable fracture, but unfortunately, the amount of sliding cannot be determined, or amount of the fracture resorption cannot be determined. This was a stable fracture where I have used a sliding hip screw. Then you can see that gradually the fracture united. But if you see the amount of sliding, the gradual collapse, that much amount of screw was outside. Gradually it has slided till it has reached the end point. So this sliding many a time is uncontrolled. This is a stable fracture I'm showing. In an unstable fracture, this sliding is much more uncontrolled. So this implant is also not a very good implant for unstable fractures. We all have seen disasters done by us only or somebody's X-ray because of this implant. And this Baumgartner's principle of tip apex distance, which was understood by that time, came really helpful. One should have a good purchase in the subchondral bone, and the tip of the screw should be as subchondral as possible definitely improves the purchase of the screw in the osteoporotic bones. To have dynamization along the shaft, Madoff plate came into the picture. Friends, this Madoff plate also did wonders, but the problem was Madoff plate also required an intact lateral wall. Basically, a pure subtrochanteric fracture could be treated with a Madoff plate if the lateral wall is broken, like a high subtrochanteric fracture or an intertrochanteric fracture with an osteoporotic lateral wall. Then this Madoff plate also did not have good control in the fixation of the fractures, and they also started failing. So unstable fracture using just a gold standard sliding hip screw is not the answer. It's not the gold standard. So you have to have some technique to reduce that medialization of the shaft, either putting a wire or by getting a valgus reduction. These are the two important things which give better results in unstable fractures when we are using for intertrochanteric fractures. Another implant came into the market, that is TSP. Again, to prevent the medialization, you can use this as a stopper. And this sits against the trochanter and prevents the medialization. This X-ray you might have seen from almost everybody's presentation on intertrochanteric fracture. This article from Denmark, which talks about the lateral wall integrity. Almost 40% of the patients during surgery, while we are using the triple reamer, the lateral wall breaks because of the osteoporosis and the thinness of the lateral wall, causing uncontrolled medialization and in turn failure. So you can see the same patient, gradually the shaft is going medially because of the sliding mechanism. Once the sliding mechanism doesn't allow further sliding, it starts cutting superiorly. The hip forces into varus and the head goes into varus, and the superior cutting through is very, very common. Here you can see on the left X-ray, a intertrochanteric fracture fixed, and within 7 days, you can see on the right side X-ray, there is medialization. The lateral wall, which was broken on the table, was not recognized by the surgeon. So this medialization starts. This medialization is the one which causes the failure of this implant in due course of time. So my question to you all is, can we predict the failure by the degree of medialization? I was thinking about this, and this article by Parker gave an excellent insight for my thoughts, where he tells that a well-done DHS or a sliding hip screw with 0% medialization, the failure is about 10%. As the medialization increases, the failure rate also increases. If the medialization is 60%, that is 60% failure rate. If the medialization is more than 90%, 100% failure. So I will tell what is this percent medialization. Here you can see that the lateral wall of the greater trochanter and the lateral wall of the shaft, about 1/4 medialization has happened. Means 1 in 4 cases will fail. Here there is about 50% medialization has happened. So 1 in 2 case will fail. Here you can see the lateral wall of the shaft is touching the medial wall of the proximal fragment. This is 100% medialization. Here you can predict that this fracture is going to fail 100%. So whenever you see a post-operative X-ray like this, you should be able to predict failure immediately and take corrective actions immediately. It's not that we have to wait for the implant to fail and the bone to cut through or the implant to cut through. We should take a corrective action immediately. So by preventing this medialization, we can prevent failure. This is the important message I want to give. This preventing medialization can be done by using a trochanteric buttress plate or an intramedullary implant. On the left, you can see a trochanteric buttress plate, which abuts against the greater trochanter, prevents medialization of the barrel plate. Similarly, on the right, you can see an intramedullary implant, again, fixing in the proximal part of the nail, fixing in the proximal fragment and distal fragment within the canal. Again, cannot allow too much of medialization. That is the reason why these implants are giving better results compared to just a surface implant. Dr. Mukhi uses a combination of this. He uses a intramedullary Ender's nail, and he also puts a wire and fixes to the second screw or the barrel. That also prevents medialization. And to prevent undue collapse at the fracture site, he also uses a fully threaded cancellous screw. He achieves compressions as required on the table to prevent undue collapse, to prevent undue sliding mechanism. He uses a screw also, fully threaded cancellous screw. This Dr. Tanna calls it as a Mukhi's concoction technique, because he has used all the mechanism to prevent sliding, like he has used the sliding hip screw, but he has used the screw to prevent compression, and also he has used the intramedullary nail to prevent medialization, as well as he has tensioned the intramedullary nail which passes through the greater trochanter with the shaft. So this is a combination of all the things which can be done best to the patient. In an osteoporotic fracture, majority of the time lateral wall breaks when we use the triple reamer. So it's prudent for us to have a TSP on table available if we are using a sliding hip screw in these fractures. This is one such case where you can see while operating, the lateral wall got broken. The surgeon immediately recognized, I don't know whether it is my case or somebody's case, that's why I'm using the word surgeon, immediately a TSP was applied. So this is what I want you to learn. If you recognize that some complication has happened, this TSP should be ready to bail you out during the surgery to prevent medialization of the shaft. Then the next part is the TSP is not always properly sitting over the trochanter, especially in elderly Indian ladies. So many a time they are proudly sitting, leading to difficulty for the patient to sleep on that side. So I have designed unused T plates which were there in the hospital. I started using them with the DHS screw, and I call them as innovative TSP. I use them over the barrel plate. One or two screws off the Richards barrel plate are passed through this plate. So this prevents medialization. Here is an example of a very short man, less than 4 feet tall person, where the medullary canal was hardly 5 millimeters. So there was no question of me using a TFN. So I used a pediatric DHS. So while doing a pediatric DHS, I realized that I have caused excessive valgus, which has broken the lateral wall. Immediately, I used this T plate, and that bailed me out in this patient. As you can see, the lateral wall was supported and the patient had an uneventful, in spite of such a severe valgus I have achieved, which that was totally unintentional. I didn't want to achieve so much of valgus. I wanted little valgus, that's all. But as you can see, even after the implants have been removed, the medialization has stopped there only. If I had not used the TSP in this case, this would have gone to uncontrolled medialization and would have led to probably to failure in this case. So this T plate and L plate can be used on any of the implant, any of the Richards plate you are using or the barrel plate you are using. I normally call this as arm admin TSP, because anybody using, instead of using a imported TSP, which is very, very costly, which only fits to few company barrel plate, it's better to use something like this, and you can have no problem while doing the surgery. Now, this is about the extramedullary implant. You all know my involvement in the intramedullary implant. Probably here today, I'm speaking to you as president of Indian Orthopedic Association because of the name and fame I could get during conducting workshops across India. This is in 1996, I conducted a workshop on interlocking nailing at Bilaspur. 97, I conducted it in Pune. 97, I conducted in Chandigarh. You can see Professor Nagi, past IOA president. In Thane, I conducted in 1998. So I have done more than 500 workshops across India, and I started spreading the knowledge of intramedullary nailing. In one of the conference at Vishakhapatnam, since I am talking to Osap Khan people, I thought, let me take this picture. I have conducted about 6 workshops in Vishakhapatnam. In one of the workshops, Dr. Anne Satish. He is from Visakhapatnam. He said, sir, DHS is the bread butter of orthopedic surgeon. We should have some keyhole surgeries, because I was demonstrating keyhole surgeries for femur and supraconal nailing at that time. So he suggested me that we should have a keyhole surgery for the DHS also. Then I worked on that and I designed the Solapur sleeve and the modified instrument for DHS. And I started doing DHS using this instrument, which are just little longer in length, that's all. Instead of triple reamer, I started using double reaming. So this is one such example which I operated. I only operated keyhole surgeries only in undisplaced or crack intertrochanteric fracture, because I'm so happy with PFN. Though this technique is mine, I hardly use this keyhole DHS. I probably do one or two in a year, that's all. So this intertrochanteric fracture has been fixed with a DHS, you can see, hardly less than 2 centimeter incision. So the landmarks I have already described in a YouTube video, you can see. This is the post-operative picture at around 3 months follow-up in the same patient. And I have done twice demonstration of same surgery at Ganga Orthopedic Trauma Course at Coimbatore in 2014, as well as in 2016, I have done the surgery. And that YouTube is, that video on the YouTube is available. You can see, search for keyhole DHS or Dr. Shiv Shankar, and you will get the keyhole DHS whole video. And Dr. S.P. Shah from Sangli also uses a similar technique, and he has used in few cases just a band-aid. That is the dressing material for a DHS he has used, and such a small scar, DHS can be done. Coming to unstable fractures, you can reduce the bending moment by getting the beak of the proximal fragment into the distal fragment if you are using a surface implant, or you can put the implant through the fracture site and get a valgus reduction. This also improves the stability of the fixation. So these are the two ways. If you are using a surface implant, you can increase the stability of fixation and get better results. As I said earlier, just a sliding hip screw, though it is called a gold standard, is not gold. You have to add copper, the copper in the form of trochanteric buttress plate or a made of plate. Then only the gold can be used for making ornaments. The 24 karat gold is just useless for the goldsmith to work on that. Unless copper is added, it can be 18 karat gold or 22 karat gold. So this copper work is done by the trochanteric buttress plate and the made of plate. So DHS alone is not the gold standard. That's what we have to know. After my MS, I have worked in England in 93 and 94 with Salman Ali in Birmingham. And also I spent time in Stuttgart with Professor Holz and Dr. K.D. Parch at Pediatric Orthopedic Center and Karin Hospital, Germany. Why I'm showing this is, during my tenure in Europe, I had the opportunity to attend few interlocking workshops in 93 and 94. And that was the time Gamma Nail had come in the market, and they were using Gamma Nail in Europe at that time. So to reduce the bending moment, as I already said, you can get the beak inside the medullary canal or get a valgus reduction. And now the last thing is, you can centralize the implant or you can put an intramedullary implant. This is the last way you can reduce the bending moment, because intramedullary implant, the reduction is in the center along the weight bearing axis. It's 400% more stronger than an extramedullary implant. One, it prevents medialization intramedullary nail, and second one, it's 400%, four times stronger than an extramedullary implant. That is the reason why nowadays we all advocate you to use an intramedullary implant for these intertrochanteric fractures, especially unstable variety, as this is a load sharing device, unlike the plate, which is a load bearing device. I cannot talk about the intramedullary implant without taking the name of this great person, Dr. Subhash Haldar from Halifax, UK. So he designed in 1982 to 1983, Halifax intramedullary nail based on Zickel's nail. So he worked on the Zickel's nail and he designed the Halifax nail, and he presented his paper between 84 to 86 at various European Congress. And he has come to India so many times. Recently, 3 months back also, I have met him on different platforms. And you can hear more about him in some of the YouTube webinars I have conducted. I'll share the link shortly. He designed the Halifax nail, and he came out to the world about the details of the Halifax nail in 1986. And this was copied by Gross from France, and he presented in 1889. Then Subhash Chandra saw that, and he immediately took objection with the How Medica, and he argued that it is his design and he should be given the credit. And as a middle path, the company compromised with Subhash Chandra. They gave royalty to him and they renamed it as Gamma Nail instead of Halifax Nail for wider acceptance. As it looks like Gamma, they named it as Gamma Nail. As I said earlier, there is a YouTube talk of about 2 hours just about the Gamma Nail, how to use it, how to reduce a fracture, and how the journey of the Gamma Nail by Dr. Subhash Chandra. This I conducted about during the lockdown period. You can go through this details in the same talk. So in 1986, the Dalvi Surgicals from Mumbai, they came out with the indigenous Gamma Nail. This is from my slide only. You can see in 1997, I have used one of my patients, Gamma Nail. I have done few Gamma Nails and I was happy with that, except that the size of the Gamma Nail was too thick proximally. That was the only problem. If the medullary canal was accommodating the nail, I was more than happy to use this nail. The problem with the Gamma Nail was it's a large implant and the distal locking was too near to the tip, single screw causing cutting, so many things. And to avoid the problem of Gamma Nail, the PFN came into the market. The people who use Gamma Nail came out with a thinner nail compared to the Gamma Nail. Then instead of having only single screw, they had two neck screws. Then the tip of the nail was thinner so that the negotiation into the medullary canal was easy. Subtrochanteric reaming was not required because the nail was thinner at the subtrochanteric region. Distal locking done away from the tip so that the stress concentration doesn't happen. All these things were incorporated in the PFN. And I was working as a Indo-German Orthopedic Foundation fellow for 6 weeks in Germany, in Dusseldorf. That was the time they were using PFN in the center where I worked. So I took pictures of that and came back to India in October. And I gave that picture to an Indian company, Yogeshwar Implant, and asked them to manufacture the nail as well as the set for that. And they did the first supply, the first set to me in December 1999. And I used it for a subtrochanteric fracture. I used this PFN only for subtrochanteric fracture or very unstable fractures initially. But in 2003, I met Dr. Gadegone from Chandrapur, who said that he is having a problem of the 25 centimeter nail because of the curvature of the femur. So he asked me to reduce the nail length to 18 centimeters. And so since he is given order for over 100 nails of 18 centimeter, the company decided to manufacture a special jig for him and also decrease the length of the nail from 25 centimeter to 18 centimeter. And that's how the TF came into picture in 2003. And I will also say here, after seeing some of the cases of Dr. Gadegone, I started using TFN even for intertrochanteric fracture. Initially, I was using this nail only for subtrochanteric fracture, but after seeing some of the cases of Gadegone, I started using this for even intertrochanteric fracture. So the TFN name has been given by myself, Dr. Gadegone, and Mr. Tushar Pandya in 2003 itself. Unfortunately, we have not patented that name. That is the reason why there are now new patented TFNs which are available in the market, which came into the market only in 2017, almost 14 years after we have done the initial nailing. So since 1999, I have been using only PFN or TFN. whatever the shortcoming, I don't say that I didn't had any problem with them. I had a lot of problem with them. And I started analyzing my own cases. And analyzing my own cases led to realizing what the problem is. And that is the reason why I thought I will talk about predictors of interlocking, predictors of a successful outcome in a hip screw. So the short nail, TFN and PFN are straight, and the long nail, I use it for a subtrochanteric or upper third fracture of the femur, which is left and right are separate, and they are site specific. So let me talk about the predictors of successful outcome while we are doing a PFN. These are the 10 commandments, very, very useful, which I have been practicing for the last almost 15 to 20 years. Just to start with, this was a case, one of my friend, I don't remember who has shared this picture with me. It was shared to me on a WhatsApp, and the surgeon asked me my opinion. I said, it's a difficult to reduce variety. Shaft will be above the shaft will be above the neck, because normally the neck will be, shaft will be sagging. But in this case, the shaft will be higher up in the lateral view. Neck will be sagging, will require traction in adduction. This doesn't require in abduction. Adduction, the traction is required. May require open reduction if the iliopsoas is interposed. DHS CC screw is a good option if you are opening the fracture. PFN only if your reduction is good. That's what I wrote to him. He had seen all my YouTube videos and tried and sent me the picture. Then I wrote to him, the nail is acting as a spacer. You can see there is a gap. He has shoveled the nail into the fracture site without making space for the nail. So this is acting as a spacer, reducing the contact between the neck fragment and the shaft fragment. So this will prevent the union. Fracture has not been compressed because he has already used a long screw. He has not compressed the fracture at the end of the tip. Then there is lateralization of the shaft. For the lateralization, I will take you to the normal side. When you put a line from the iliac crest, outermost part, the lateralmost part of the greater trochanter, it grazes through the lateralmost part of the greater trochanter, or it will be just inside. This is the normal anatomy. Here you can see when I draw the lane, the greater trochanter is outside. That has caused, because the nail is acting as a spacer, it has caused lateralization of the shaft. So I told him, even if the fracture unites, the patient will have a Trendelenburg gait because of this lateralized. So one, it may not unite because the nail is acting as a spacer, high chances of failure. Even if by chance the fracture unites, patient will never have a good gait. So that's what we should learn to analyze our own x-rays and predict our results. This is Professor Joydeep Das from Gurudwan Medical College. He sent me an x-ray. Sir, I did this case last week. Please comment. The helical blade had crossed the safety limit. The helical blade is supposed to be 10 millimeter from the subchondral bone. Here it is less than 2 millimeter. Will it perforate or back out? This was this question. I wrote to him immediately. So 2149, he said 2251, I replied. Since the back end of the helical blade is out of lateral cortex, the penetration chances are less and sliding chances are more, unless the sliding mechanism gets jammed, which is less than 10%. So you can see that the back end of the helical blade is out, so it can slide out easily. And after 6 weeks on fifth centimeter, he says, sir, as you predicted, there is no cut through or penetration, and it has collapsed. The fracture has collapsed and the screw has backed out. Happy Teacher's Day. Thank you very much. This is what he writes. So these are some of the people who have shared their x-rays with me, also has helped me to analyze the fractures. So that is the reason why I'm sharing. Learn to predict the outcome by knowing the deficiency in your surgery. You should know what you have done in your patient, and accordingly, you should start tackling the issues. So this is a busy slide. I will take one after the other, each point. A good implant from a known company is very, very important. Just take a substandard copy. Here you can see the locking near the tip. We don't want in a PFN. It has to be away. Here, there is no tapering of the distal part. There is no screw head. So there are so many shortcomings in this nail. that PFN has a tapering end for easy negotiation into the medullary canal. That is also very, very important to avoid stress. So just a copy is not at all good. And the end result is here, it is a proximal end is thin. Normal PFN is 15 millimeter Indian. Here it is a 13 millimeter PFN. So it has bent and broke at the whole site. Reduction is also very, very important. Good anterior reduction. So that is very, very most important thing. We all know that posteromedial fragment and this where the weight bearing maximally happens. So this is not something new. I am talking in 1984 in Jewett has written an article about the posteromedial fragment is the cause for the instability. What I am talking is it's not the posteromedial cortex. It's the reduction of the anteromedial cortex because we cannot see the posterior cortex in an osteoporotic bone. We can see only a thick anterior cortex, which is stronger bone. So if we reduce the anterior cortex properly, the posterior cortex will also get aligned properly. Anterior cortex is thick bone. It breaks into few pieces. So putting them back is easy. Whereas posterior cortex is an osteoporotic bone. You cannot see on an X-ray or a CM. So putting them back in alignment is very, very difficult. So if you reduce the anterior cortex, the posterior cortex automatically comes in alignment. Just to give an example, if you put the first button of your shirt properly, the last button also will come properly. First button, I'm comparing with the anterior cortex and the last button with the posterior cortex. So try to reduce the anterior cortex properly. Automatically, the posterior cortex will come in alignment. Otherwise, the gap like this will happen. So you have to reduce beautifully. 100% reduction has to be there. Even if there is a 25% reduction anteriorly, there is 25% loss in the posterior aspect and the fracture may not unite. Simple tools are useful, especially the Steenmann pin, which you can use to push or pull the fragment. This is a 2007 X-ray where you can see that I have used a Steenmann pin. This is the Steenmann pin. I'm pushing the neck. Once the fracture was aligned, I fixed with a K-wire. Then taking an entry. So this is very, very important. Reduce and fix the fracture with K-wire. You can use any instrument. A Hohmann spatula can also be used to reduce it properly and get a good anterior reduction. So normally what I do is when the anterior cortex is not reduced properly, I insert a Steenmann pin into the fracture site, elevate the depressed neck or the shaft, whichever is elevated, then fix with a K-wire. And if that K-wire is coming in the way of my nail, then I'll additionally add few more KYs very anteriorly within the bone and then take out the one which was interfering with my nailing or passing a DHS, then I'll carry out the nailing. Once KYs are fixed into the fracture site, you can adapt it without the worry of fracture going to varus. This is another reason why you have to use KYs. So the entry cannot be made with an abducted position from the medial to piriformis fossa, but after fixing the fracture, you can make a good entry and you can adduct the leg and do a nailing very easily and comfortably in any of the OTs. This is a very elderly lady with a two weeks old fracture where there was hardly any posterior cortex. The posterior cortex was totally missing. And I did the nailing. I used a Halifax nail in this case. And as you can see, in due course of time, at 3 weeks, at 3 months, you can see the bone has formed. So bone forms where it is required. Only thing you have to do is the alignment of the bone should be proper and your fixation should be good enough that you should start the mobilization early. Then only the bone will start forming. This is at 8 months post-operative. You can see beautiful reduction and beautiful consolidation. Friends, this provisional fixation of K-wire has come only recently in 2015 and in 2009, Dr. Carr had published one paper, Steenmann pin reduction, but I have been doing much more earlier than this. This is a CD of 2005, where I have used this technique of fixing the fracture with the two K wires. So this is you can see there are two K wires I have passed. It was a demonstration surgery I did Aurangabad, where Dr. Khanna was coordinating from the hall, Dr. Gade. So using this, stable fracture, I've tried long time back. Here you can see, even it was a stable fracture which I had done the demonstration. This video is also available on the YouTube. In 2005 onwards only, I am using this technique of fixing with the KYS. Unfortunately, I have not published this data. As recently Dr. L. Prakash said, it's not that you have to publish the data if there are many followers. I have thousands of followers of this technique, and every day I do keep getting a message saying that this technique has helped a lot to improve their quality of outcome. Even a stable fracture, crack fracture also, I always fix before putting a nail. Because when you try to put the reamer, the fracture opens up superiorly. So even an undisplaced crack fracture also, always I use a KY to fix the fracture. The next point is good medial reduction. As I already said, medial part transmits the weight along the calcar. So medial part has to be reduced properly. If there is a huge butterfly fragment, I don't mind opening and putting them back with ensertage wire, because getting anatomical reduction medially is very, very important. And recently, this article about the positive, neutral, and negative cortical reduction has come, which talks about the beak of the proximal fragment. This is a negative cortical support where the beak is inside the medullary canal. This should not be accepted. This is a neutral cortical support, and this is a positive cortical support. I advocate everybody to get a positive cortical support so that the beak can never go inside. In a neutral position also, sometimes it can slip inside. So try to get the beak slightly out. Let the beak be slightly inferior than the beak of the shaft so that it can never go into the medullary canal. That is what I advise. I have been advising this. If you go through some of my earlier talk, the same I have been telling as valgus reduction. The beak inside distal canal is negative. Beak touching the shaft is neutral. Beak outside, you should do this. This is a 2007 X-ray. The beak outside is positive cortical support. With beak inside, only with a surface implant we can get valgus. With the intramedullary implant, if beak is inside, it's always varus, 100% varus. So this is a beautifully done case if you see the day one X-ray. But if you analyze the fracture, you can see that the beak of the neck is inside the canal. In due course of time, what has happened is the fracture has failed. The implant has failed because of this uncontrolled medialization. So the beak has to be out not only in AP picture, it has to be out on lateral picture also. So that you should take care to see. Prakash, how much time I have? Yes?
Five more minutes.
Okay, fine. Thank you. So beak, this is another good neutral support, but there is a lesser trochanter oval, so it has gone into the shaft. So this should be avoided. That's the reason why I tell that beak has to be out. See, this was a case somebody was doing, one of my friend, Dr. Manmath Raut, and he called me. When I saw the beak which was inside, I said, this is not the reduction we should aim. I used a bone hook, pulled the gate trochanter out, got the reduction properly, then I inserted the nail. And this case, you can see such a badly comminuted fracture with a neutral cortical support healed without any problem in the subsequent follow-up. Another, you can see a valgus reduction and a good compression which has led to union in this fracture. This is a 2008 X-ray I'm sharing here. So getting a valgus out or a positive cortical support is very, very important. Next point is the screw should be center or inferior to the center in the AP, and it should be central in lateral or slightly posterior in lateral view. Tip apex distance should be less than 25 millimeter, both in AP and lateral. Unfortunately, if you are using a PFN, or as I advocate, this tip apex distance, if you measure, I think I have gone to the next topic, screw length. Okay. If you measure from the fovea centralis, if the screw is in the center of the neck only, your TAD will be less. If the screw is slightly inferior, which is what I normally advocate, if I measure the TAD, it will be more than 25 millimeter. So you should not measure the TAD in this case. You have to measure calcar TAD or cal TAD. What is this cal TAD? Cal TAD is extrapolate the screw to the subchondral bone and measure the distance from the subchondral bone to the tip of the screw. This is calcar TAD, which is very, very important. Again, the screw length, The screw should be, both of them should be at the same horizontal level. Superior screw should be slightly shorter so that both of them take the load simultaneously as the hip is loaded, so that both can slide simultaneously out. This is a beautiful article by Henschel. He talks about different lengths of screws, superior longer, superior shorter, inferior longer, inferior shorter, both longer, both shorter, all the options he has used in the computer, and the finite analysis they have done, and they have come to a conclusion that if both the screws are at the same horizontal level and there is smooth sliding with little varus malformation, and both the screws will slide simultaneously, allowing the collapse to happen. If there is a void medially and the superior screw is longer, what happens is when the screw is loaded, the superior screw takes the load, causing varus force to act more. That will cause, especially if the inferior, there is lesser trochanteric avulse, the varus forces causes the inferior screw to slide out and jamming of the superior screw. The jammed superior screw, whenever the patient lifts the leg, the screw tends to move inside. That is the cause for Z effect. So that is the reason why your derotation screw should be slightly shorter than the cervical screw. You should compress the fracture on table so that the fracture should not beg for more compression. Sliding should not happen. So you can see in this case of 2007, the lateral end, the head of the screw is touching the lateral wall at 14 months after the fracture union in a 75-year-old lady. The screw has not slided back. That indicates that adequate compression could be achieved on table. So how I do it? So this, once you compress the lateral wall, this is at 3 months, you can see the screws are not sliding out. So this is very, very important. So how I do it? I release the foot end traction and alternately compress both the cervical and derotation screw till my satisfaction. Since this is a screw, I can compress 3 mm, 4 mm, whatever is required. The system doesn't leak. A little bit about the comminuted lateral wall fractures. This is the Gottfried has classified this as a shattered lateral wall, new variety. And this article by Hu in from Taiwan says that if the lateral wall is less than 20.5 millimeter, one should not use the DHS. It has it, the chances of breakage is very, very high. And to tackle, our friends, Dr. Naveen Thakkar, Shashikant Ganjale have designed trochanteric butter state. Dr. Sushrut Babulkar and Sunil Kulkarni have designed trochanteric wiring. I have my own way of tackling. I will share with you. It is not published data. This is Dr. Naveen Thakkar uses a trochanteric buttress plate. This is Dr. Ganjale. He also uses a trochanteric buttress plate. This is an example from him only where he has used this thin trochanteric buttress plate. Then Dr. Sushrut and Sushrut Babulkar and Sunil Kulkarni have published this wiring technique. That is also a good method. I use only a screw if the lateral wall is big enough to put a screw. That also has been published. If the lateral wall is big chunk of bone in an adult, I don't mind putting a screw to fix the lateral wall. This is the only indication for me to fix the lateral wall. Another case, similarly, I have done a lateral wall I have fixed with a screw, and then I have carried out the nailing in this patient. So fixing lateral wall only if the lateral wall is a big chunk of bone. If the medial wall is separate and the lateral wall is comminuted, then a fracture like this, I don't mind putting a wire, because anyway, for getting the calcar reduction, I have to open, so I don't mind putting a wire. If the fracture is displaced and the bone is quite strong,
you have a little experience.
Sometimes I have used a plate. It's not that I always use a plate. Sometime I use it. My cases of plating with a nail is less than 10 cases in the last 20 years. So I don't say that I do it very frequently. In an osteoporotic fracture, all the fragments together. But if there is a good way I can put a screw, I don't mind putting a screw through that good bone, taking care that it doesn't shatter further. So this is another way of tackling. If the lateral wall is totally shattered, I don't use the lateral wall. I use the nail as the lateral wall. Here you can see the screw of the cervical screw is touching the nail, which is passing through the fracture site. and that will good beautiful reduction and results. This is a demonstration case I did at Sancheti Hospital in Pune. The lateral wall was missing in this case. Medial wall was also missing. What I did, I got extra valgus for compensate the medial valgus. The screw of the cervical screw touching the nail acted as the lateral wall, and the nail acting as the lateral wall. At 1 month, you can see already the consolidation has started. This was a 2 weeks old fracture I had operated. Well, technically, it's a 6 weeks post-operative picture. So this I call it as Tushenka's technique of tackling deficit lateral wall. This can be done. Another comminuted fracture, badly comminuted fracture. You can see nail is being used as a lateral wall, and it has good, excellent result in my hand. So this is very important, especially I feel that lateral wall, the bone has to be supported by the screw head. If the screw head is not supported, then it can toggle up and down. That will cause loss of fixation of the screws and the, in the head and the screw to come out. So this is the reason why, Dr. Mukhi, you can see this fully threaded cancellous screw is being used to prevent collapse. If the collapse is allowed by partial thread screw, the failure is almost 30%. That is the reason why we use a Powell screw, especially we are tackling a transcervical fracture. The similar Mukhi's technique of using concoction, again, a fully threaded screw to prevent collapse. This collapse should be prevented, or the lateral wall should be touching the nail or the lateral wall. That is very, very important. This is another 85-year-old man. Again, you can see the lateral wall was not there. So I have the, my screw heads are touching the lateral wall. I allow patient to walk. Whatever is my decision, I always allow them to walk. At 10 weeks post-operative, when they came, the screws are not backing out. Very, very important. The patient was so thankful. He literally cried. He said that at this age of 85, he never thought that he will survive. So he cried. I have captured this in my picture. I have the permission. I told him that I'll be using in my presentation. He said, "Aap kidhar bhi dikhao, Dr. Saab, I am very thankful to you. Allah aapka bhala kare." This is what the blessing he gave to me. This is, I operated it during Ganga operative trauma course. Badly comminuted lateral wall in a 74-year female. You can see that I used the, as the bone was okay at that site, I have used only a good reduction. I had not tackled, done anything for the lateral wall. This is after 3.5 years, you can see beautiful consolidation. Slight collapses happened. Probably I have not compressed the fracture properly. The reason is, here I was using an imported screw. I have to take it from a sterile pack. I didn't want to use another one. So otherwise, probably in my setup, I use an Indian implant. I take it out and put a shorter screw. So thanks to Deen Dayalan and Rajkumar for sharing this X-rays with me. Devendra also. Another case, lateral wall is broken. Again, similarly, you can see I have used the screw against the nail and the fracture has united at 4.5 years without any problem. Unfortunately, the original synthesis nail also is not having a head. So original synthesis screw is also not very good. I say that Indian implant with a screw is most important to have this lateral wall being tackled with the implant itself. So these are some of the examples of my technique where I already shown. Unfortunately, none of the newer implant, PFNA2, ZNN, Trigen, the Halifax, none of them have got a head for the neck screw. That's why they are not good for using in a lateral wall comminuted fracture. They are good for other fractures, but in a lateral wall combination, there is no role for them. In the ninth point is, in a headless screw, the back end of the screw should be slightly outside so that the fracture should collapse and then the screw should come out. If it is inside, it may come in the way of the collapse, and if it is inside, then it can give trouble. This is my own case where I have used a ZNN. What happens is, if the screw is slightly out, it can slide out. If it is inside the lateral wall, the hole may not match with the neck screw and it will prevent the sliding. So this is what on 21st, Dr. Yajuvendra Singh Shekhawat from Toja City sent me an X-ray where you can see the lateral wall, it has penetrated. I wrote to him saying that the weld done at the back end of helical plate can get jammed while sliding. It has to be, it may penetrate the lateral wall. Also due to longer blade nearer the articular surface, high penetration chances. Please remember to share X-rays now as well as the future. So this is an immediate post-operative X-ray which shows that slightly it is inside. So back end should be slightly out. This is what I already showed, that if the back end of this screw is outside, though it is subchondral bone, it can slide out without any problem, as you can see in this case of Professor Dr. Jaideep Das from Burdwan Medical College. So you should be able to predict this. This is what I am telling. Once you learn what are the mistakes you have done, and if you predict the outcome, you can do that. Last but not the least, the tip of the nail should be slightly out at the entry side. If it is inside, it can also go medially like an uncontrolled DHS. Again, one more case where the nail was slightly inside led to failure. Though a very well done case, but it has gone to failure because the nail tip was not outside the nail. It should not be buried inside. If the nail tip is inside the bone, try to build up using a cap. Many of the companies do provide this different sizes cap. So yesterday only, Dr. Kota Aditya, he shared me a picture. So operated this case, sir, used all your technique, and he shared me the X-ray. As you can see, the X-ray, entry should have been medial to the greater trochanter. It has been done through the factor side. Little more valgus was required as there is medial gap because of the loss of lesser trochanter, and the beak is going inside the medial canal. This is negative cortical support. Cervical screw inferior in the neck should be inferior in the head also. Here it is already in the center. So never use fracture site as the entry site. That's what I wrote him. Nail is acting as a spacer. The fracture surfaces are kept away by the nail. Whereas as lateralization of the shaft has happened, all this will lead to high chances of failure. Please send me pelvis with both hips X-ray now and also follow-up X-ray. That's what I wrote him. Yesterday evening only at 5 o'clock, he has shared this. Since I was preparing this presentation, I thought I'll use this. So friends, this is the last slide I'm showing. So be analyze your own mistakes and try to predict the outcome of the PFN and try to improve in our next case. Thank you very much. I would like to thank OSAPCON for giving this